there is infertile women from Kenya, and as you see, she didn't know what was happening to her. She didn't know that she has other options. And Merck More Than a Mother is an initiative. The aim of this initiative is to empower these type of women, these barren, infertile women in Africa, through improving access to information, health, but most importantly, change of mindset and culture shift, and also empowering them economically and socially so they can be independent. As you know, in many cultures, women are raised to be like a baby-making machine. And if they failed to achieve this purpose, they just wait to die. And they accept any kind of insult and mistreatment and discrimination, which is a lot, by their husbands, families, and community. And of course, having this, it's not right. I mean, you cannot just watch them and say, it's not our business. We have to do something. And that's why we have all this commitment here from our ministers, parliament members, different sectors, not only healthcare, ministers of genders, ministers of education, ministers of even land and property. You know that women are not allowed to inherit from their families. They're only allowed to inherit in Africa, and they're only allowed to inherit from their husband families. If they have no children, they don't have anything. So although the 50% of the causes of infertility is due to male factor, they still just the only one to be blamed for being infertile, and men refuse totally to admit they have any problem or even go for test or treatment. And this, of course, will not result in any solution of the problem. We are not talking about small percentage like any country. As per WHO data, one every four couples in Africa and developing countries are suffering from infertility. But there is another important number here. 85% of these cases can be prevented. It's actually due to untreated infectious diseases. For all the wrong, you know, habits and things we're doing in Africa, we are advocate for child marriage, unsafe abortion, unsafe delivery, genital mutation, sexual infection, HIV, infectious diseases. And I agree with Dr. Cheryl. She said that women prefer to have HIV, infected by HIV, than being infertile. And this is actually the case. And they actually rather to lose their life and have a child. And this could be an opportunity and a challenge, because when we said how we would prevent infertility, we said women rather to have be infected than having being infertile. So why not integrated all the prevention awareness messages with the child and the mother and child programs, HIV programs, and infectious disease programs? Maybe it will also contribute to prevent these infectious diseases. So I will not talk too much. There is a lot of interventions we defined with all our partners, which I'm going to call now to the panel, ranging from awareness about infertility and male infertility and management, up to building advocacy to change a culture of disrespecting infertile women, and also about training, because we know that to have access to information and health, you need to train embryologists and doctors in Africa, and this is also what we are going to talk about briefly during our panel. And lastly, this is all for the future: prevention, awareness, treatment, education. But what about the women who is in a very, very big number in Africa, who's infertile and cannot have children anymore due to their age or biological cases? So what we are going to do with them? Just leave them to share their experience. Like Grace, you have to stay tuned with us and see what we are going to do to help these women who is we are too late for them to be treated. Minister of State of Health, Minister Sarah Obindi, as Merck More Than a Mother ambassador for Uganda,
We have done a lot of interventions, and we still on the way, because there is a long way to go to change the culture and to raise awareness. Can you talk to us about what measures the Ministry of Health of Uganda are taking now to integrate the awareness messages and to change the culture in Uganda?
Thank you very much, Dr. Rasha. First of all, congratulate the organizers of this 22nd IFFS Congress. And I note that this Congress has been taking place, but at political level, the politicians, the policymakers are not so much engaged into this talk. And as a result, it has remained at technical level. We know very well that infertility has existed since man was created, right from the time of Abraham and Sarah, but not much is talked about. Couples suffer in silence, and in Uganda, we are aware that between 15 to 20% of the couples that attempt to conceive actually fail. So we have a number of clinics that do offer fertility care services. However, these are private clinics, and of course the services are very expensive. The ordinary person cannot afford. So it costs between $3,000 to $5,000 for one to go through the entire process. So as a country, of course, Merck did approach us. And of course, at political level, we decided to take this campaign on to create awareness and show the population that infertility can actually be prevented, but also integrated into healthcare services. So in February this year, that's when we launched the campaign to raise awareness among us, the population, about infertility. And of course, as Ministry of Health, we are now integrating the infertility care services into our services and creating awareness. When we talk about reproductive health, we have mainly been focusing on family planning, contraceptives, and discussing about maternal mortality. But not much has been done in creating awareness about infertility. So as we speak now as a country, this is one of the issues that we are tackling. And of course, we have primary health care services being offered free of charge. So when women go to the health facilities, they are supposed to be told about HIV/AIDS, family planning, and as well about infertility and how to prevent infertility. So currently we are constructing state-of-the-art women's hospital. This will be a national hospital, and of course once it's complete in June 2017, we hope that for the first time we shall have services offered to our people, to the men and women, at a fairly affordable price or affordable cost. So this is one of the things that we are doing as government of Uganda, and of course with support from Merck. As I did indicate, the clinics, the fertility care clinics that are available are private. We have about five, and of course even the specialists are not available in the public health facilities. So we hope that once this public hospital, the state-of-the-art women's hospital, is complete, we shall be able to employ these embryologists that Merck has trained for us, and of course other experts in this women's hospital. So this is one of the things that we are doing as government of Uganda, and of course we want to bring on board all the policymakers, all the stakeholders, to begin talking openly about fertility so that the people in the rural areas can actually know and go and access services where possible.
Thank you very much, Minister Sarah. It's a great effort, and it's a really role model for a lot of sub-Saharan African countries. Because this story comes from Kenya, and Honorable Joyce Leigh is a member of Parliament of Kenya and ambassador of Merck More than a Mother. She actually was with Jacqueline most of the times. So she can comment on this and what is about the new policy you are doing for ART regulation for the first time in sub-Saharan African countries.
Thank you very much, Russia. it is a sad state to see what Jacqueline went through. And Jacqueline's case is not the first case in Africa. This shows you how women are suffering, women who are undergoing infertility marriages. Because the way we are wired in Africa, whenever we talk about infertility, you get married 1 year, 2 years down the line, you don't have children, the first blame goes to the woman. It is the woman who carries the shame, the embarrassment. She's the one who carries the tears at night that nobody sees. In Jacqueline's case, it is the husband who had the problem. But because infertility is not spoken out loud, they had no platform or avenue of sharing their problem. Creating awareness, information, and education is very important when it comes to matters infertility. Because the frustration of the couple is very grave. And especially when it is a man who has a problem. Because normally a man will not come out to talk about the issue. Because to them maybe it's related to some kind of weakness to say that you have an infertility problem. So you can imagine the pain that a man will go through knowing that I cannot give my wife a baby. In that form of fear and frustration and anger, thinking maybe now my woman will go and have kids with maybe another man, maybe she will leave me. That's the case of Jacqueline and her husband. Nobody should go through what Jacqueline went through. And that's why this campaign is called Merck More Than a Mother, because you are a woman. It doesn't matter, you have children or you don't have children, you are more than a mother. I want to thank More Than a Mother campaign because through the campaign, we've opened up avenues of discussion in the country. The conversations have started. Even the television station, last week we had a very big program on KTN to talk about infertility and couples that are suffering infertility, and also to talk about alternatives that are available. It's a conversation that needs to continue. It's a conversation that needs to be taken everywhere, in every board meeting, in every church, in every school, in every market. Let's talk about it openly. Because by talking, we help people like Jacqueline and the husband, for them to know that we can face the world, we can find alternatives, we can find treatment. Early detection, early treatment, it's very important. That's the message that we need to take out there, because according to the research, as Dr. Rasha has said, 85% is caused by untreated infections, which means people don't access the information. Where we come in as legislators also is to make sure that we create policies that govern and also regulate and also help people to understand what methods are available for couples who are facing infertility. In Kenya, we've come up with the first bill, Assisted Reproductive Technology Bill. We've already debated it at the National Assembly, and it got overwhelming support. It's amazing when you start this conversation, amazing how people come out now to say, we were waiting for this bill. Some of them, even male members of parliament, they are very supportive of the bill. And they came out also to give us all support that we needed. And ART has been happening in Kenya, but then we didn't have a law that was regulating it. And most of the times you find it, they are in private clinics, not in government hospitals. So through the bill, after, right now it's at the Senate level, it's going to be debated in the Senate. After it becomes law, we will be able to push the government to make sure that we have enough budget allocated towards infertility and to make sure that we have infertility clinics in major government hospitals in the country. And also to assist women who undergo or who get children maybe through surrogate mother, because it also talks about surrogacy. It's the first law that we're going to have on surrogacy in Kenya, so that when you have a child maybe through a surrogate mother, the law should recognize you as the mother of that child. So it's a huge milestone, and I also want to thank other countries that are also coming up with their own draft on infertility. And we thank you. Yes, Nigeria also has come up with a draft. And we also want to thank you, because every time you meet, you talk about infertility, and this panel needs to continue discussing about these matters and make sure that we reach out to the level where Jacqueline lives, because that's where the lack of information is also found. Thank you so much, Rasha.
When we talk about this issue, it's a culture issue. It will take a long time to change. But as you said, when we demonstrate the suffering of the women and they see it firsthand, not only talking about it, people change their mind and they actually think why we are hurting them. We didn't know that we are hurting them that much. So the culture is very important, and that's why the role of Minister of Gender and or Minister of Women Affairs in other countries is very, very important. And it's not only about Ministry of Health and Women of Parliament and healthcare providers and the pharmaceutical industry. There is a multi-sectoral partnerships and cooperation should integrate. When you're talking about culture and change of culture, everyone should partner and should cooperate and get engaged in this conversation and the call for actions. And I will leave the mic to Minister Julia. She is Minister of Gender and Social Development, to talk to us about how can we change the culture, how can we create culture shifts so no one else, no other women can suffer the same way Jacqueline did.
You've seen the story of Grace and Jacqueline, and there are so many others like them out there. If women are in power, if women are given the opportunity to be themselves, you will understand that women are more than a mother. Yes, you can set up all the laws, the policies. Domestic violence law, you saw Jackie was violated. But it has to do with changing minds and changing attitudes. Changing the way the family, the community, the society look at one another. I always tell this story. Growing up, your parents want you to be a healthy child. They want you to go to school and learn. Then they look to you getting married. And once you get married, then you start having pressure of having children. And to all of the mothers and women in this room, most of what is happening or what the pressure comes from is from the mothers. So mothers, we need to change our minds. We need to change our attitudes towards our children. Your son gets married, next time you ask him, where's my grandchild? Your daughter gets married, ask her, where's my grandchild? You're not asking them about their health. You're not asking them about what they would like to do next in their marriage. You are putting pressure on them to have a baby. Most of the mothers too, especially on our continent of Africa, where early child marriage, teenage pregnancy, FGM, those are all some of the causes that leads to infertility on the woman. But it's both men and women. So we need to all now look back and see how we can create and develop more messages using the media, using social media, on educating our people in the rural areas, our people that this issue is not an individual issue, rather it's a societal issue, it's a community issue, and that we should look at women not just as a mother, but that a woman is more than a mother. So with this program launched by Merck More Than a Mother, we hope that it just don't stop in Kenya, Uganda, Liberia, Nigeria, Cote d'Ivoire, but all over, so that people can understand that there are so many factors that leads to infertility, but with the right information, the right places to go, it can be prevented. Prevention, prevention, education, education, the empowering of women, and to the family, allowing your daughters to be themselves, allowing your sons to respect the spouse. It goes both ways. This is a societal issue. This is a community issue. So going down to the community level, I'm so glad to be part of this Congress this morning, listening to the doctors from WHO. Saw the incident from the Ebola research that was done in Sierra Leone. In Liberia, you know, we were hit hard to Ebola. Similar research was done. But I was saying to Doc, during the period of that time when we're telling the women, telling the men, yes, you just got out of the Ebola center, but try to stay away from your wife at least for a certain period. The man took an exception and he started to abuse the wives and said because they think she has another partner. But the Ebola started coming back because of that. Violence against women should not be tolerated. Stigmatization should not be tolerated. We get all together in this room, use the media, use advocacy to educate our people out there so that we all can change our minds and change our attitude and let people know out there that more than a mother means a lot to all of us. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much. There is a lot of people asked us what we are doing for these women. We have in our social media a lot of stories of infertile women sharing their sad experience, devastated experience with us, sort of sharing experience and also advising the new and young couples and raising awareness about the whole cause and showing that mistreatment and discrimination of infertile women actually hurt a human being. So people ask us what we are going to do to support these women. Are you going to just walk away and tell them, sorry, bad luck, it's too late for you? No, actually we didn't. And we created a program called Empowering Berna. So all these infertile women who cannot have children anymore because they are old, older to have children or for biological situation because some of the women due to infection, they lost all the ovaries and tubes and everything. So there is no hope to have children. So we said we created this program to empower them economically, establish for them small business so they can be independent and they have income by themselves so they don't wait to be a baby making machine or they lost the purpose in their life and they earn respect of the society. I will ask Honorable Betty Amongi because we had a project together with Minister Sara Obindi as well to identify these women across all Uganda, and we have identified almost 1,000 women up till now in this case. How we will help these women, and how did you identify them?
Like she has clearly put it, the empowerment of these women are very important because most of the women, if you don't empower them, they will have no option of where to go. When you look at the first video, the lady who was crying stated that the husband told her to go back to her home. And yet in African culture, when you are married, marriage gives you right to property, marriage gives you right to ownership of land, marriage gives you ownership to succession, and therefore, where you are married is where the social entitlement of land ownership, of property ownership and rights are anchored on a woman. So when you don't give birth, you are either forced to go back where you are born, and where you are born, most likely they have already split the property among the sons. And so the sons will not want you to go back home. So most of these women are in the middle of nowhere. That's why the empowerment becomes very crucial. In Uganda, we have so far registered more than 500 women. We have a local government system from village to parish to district where we use the local leaders to register the women who are infertile. After registering them, we put them in groups and ask them what economic activity would be able to empower them and be able to enable them to get those social economic entitlements that, in other words, they have missed because they are not married. At the moment, most of them, we facilitate them to choose their own enterprises. And we have women who have chosen enterprises like putting up restaurants. Some have chosen probably doing selling maybe food stuff. Others have chosen tailoring. So in all these countries, including Kenya, you find women have chosen economic activity that will enable them to sustain themselves and sustain their lives. And this we want to thank Merck More Than a Mother and the commitment of Russia herself, who has been with us throughout, who has moved to the field with us, who have reached out to these women and seen their suffering, and at the moment we are able to give them economic empowerment that will now make them stable and sustain themselves as independent human beings, and also continue to empower others. When you look at all the videos, most of them were given information. We do not only give them the economic activity, we also give them information. So they become change agents in their community. They continue to advise other women who are infertile, other young women, that infertility is not only a matter of a woman, but also a man can have a problem. We also let them know where they can refer other people, in which hospital, and how this can be diagnosed. So empowerment is going hand in hand with information and awareness creation. So that is what we are doing, and we want to thank Merck More Than a Mother. Thank you.
Very, very much. Thank you. I would like to invite Professor Joe Sampson to tell us, what do you think about this campaign? And we will talk later about also the training, but I want you to tell me your opinion about the whole culture things. After you watch our videos and experience this at firsthand with Merck More Than a Mother.
On behalf of the International Federation of Fertility Societies, and I think I speak for all of the non-governmental organizations in official relations with WHO, the American Society of Reproductive Medicine, ICMARC, and the International Federation of Gynecology and Obstetrics, FIGO. I think as health providers, we all have compassion. That's one of the reasons why we went into medicine and into the health-related fields. I think we see in this program, Merck More Than a Mother, two components, one of which we cannot provide directly as providers, and that is the economic benefits, the support that unfortunate individuals like Grace are left with. And I think the philanthropic and the governmental organizations that have stepped up to the plate are to be commended. And it takes more than just a governmental organization. It takes publicity. It takes a dedicated individual, such as the ministers and the parliamentarians that are involved in this particular program. And we applaud that, and we will do what we can to validate that this is a very solid approach that is obligatory, because there are certain things that we in medicine simply cannot produce in 2016, but we look forward to doing more in the future than now, because after all, 40 years ago, we could not generate reliable in vitro fertilization to the extent that we have now. So there's every reason to think that's changed. I think we have other obligations as well. All of the NGOs, certainly IFFS, have education as an absolute component of that. That's what this meeting is about. It's to give cutting edge science and cutting edge clinical implementation of those therapies that we know to be truthful. So we start at the very basic, but we also have to look at delivery. Increasingly, all of us in high resource countries have an increasing interest and obligation to provide education and to provide service, and also to translate in the shortest period of time the advances that have been made in our laboratory to middle and lower resource countries. And increasingly the message is out among young physicians that there is a global responsibility. We see changes over the decades that have been dramatic in terms of what's there. So this is a spectacular program. It has all of the components from those individuals for whom we cannot help in the profession for their immediate needs, but at the same time, they continue to remind us that we need to work and to translate and to make available the increasing capacity that will diminish the graces of this world and make it sure that problems are recognized and treated in the most expeditious fashion. So I congratulate you and thank you very much.
That's why we are going to integrate and cooperate with Ministry of Communication, because as you said, media and communication is very important, and they will be part of our advisory board, and also Ministry of Education, because we need to integrate educational messages about infertility in the curriculum of the students, at least in the high school. So we have a partnership with the UNESCO, and we have all the ambassadors of UNESCO in Africa, who's of course delegates of the Ministry of Education in different African countries. We will work on this during our summit in Ethiopia, where Professor Simpson also will be there. And now my question goes to Professor Ashiro, the president of Africa Fertility Society. We worked on this campaign from the start together, and you have also your opinion about the different challenges of infertility in Africa. Can you give us a small brief from your experience?
It's nice to be here again. And I think that I'm happy that IFFS has taken up this challenge. And we have around here at least Dr. James Kieri from WHO. There is a big, big problem in Africa. And what you are seeing is just the tip of the iceberg. I have been involved in reproductive medicine since 1974. At that time, what was being preached to us in Africa was Population Council. The United Nations Population Fund ensured that we were doing family planning and family planning. But doing my research work in reproduction, I recognized the fact there is a problem of fertility in Africa. And since my involvement in this area, since 1978, when patients come to the clinic, they are afraid to come to a fertility clinic. They don't want people to know that they are taking treatment for infertility, because they would think that something went wrong with them at their early period. In most of these cases, only the women will show up, not the men. Now, the consequences of this has been that most people will prefer to go to a pastor, to a religious house, to treat infertility. So by the time the doctors see most of these people, it's too late. So we're happy that Merck is now launching this process in Nigeria and in Africa in general. And this cultural shift will enable many, many people in the rural and other areas to seek now the proper treatment for infertility, and to recognize the fact that there is respect for womanhood than motherhood. At the end of the day, even if you do not have this baby, woman who still has a good role in creation than just having babies. And as somebody said, women are not just like a baby factory. It's a togetherness event. And in Africa, especially in Nigeria, we found out now that because of the advances in reproductive technology, men who have low sperm or who did not have any, they now know that there are reproductive options. So they now come forward for fertility treatment. Consequently, the more we show that there is technology to help these people, the more they will come and take those resources. Finally, I think that I must thank Mark for this initiative, especially Russia, who has taken this like a serious passion for herself, and that 5 years, 10 years from now, as Jacquem predicted, maybe by 2020, IVF success should be almost close to 85%, 90%, so that the creation in the world can have babies like we had before and like we were meant to have, and we can remove all the problems of having babies like environmental toxins and awareness just from the population that there is solution. And with the help of IFFS, WHO, ICMAC, and the rest of them, the world will be a better place for all of us. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. And I actually would like to also thank WHO, because when I started this program and this campaign, I didn't have too much support, too many supporters, as you know. Everyone said Africa is overpopulated. Why you want to do this in Africa? I mean, there is no food, there is all infectious diseases, HIV and other things. We don't have any time or money for supporting infertility. And the only data I have and information I have from the WHO, which I used, and without it actually, I think no one would pay me any attention. So I'd like to thank WHO for this, because without it, it will never come up to light. So, now I would like to emphasize on a very, very, very important initiative, which is Merck Africa Embryology Training Program. When we started in Africa, there was no embryologist. I mean, in sub-Saharan Africa, there is no African embryologist. They get embryologists out from outside, from Europe or South Africa or Egypt. And of course, this affects the quality, as you know, and the cost. And we said if we want to improve access or even to consider building IVF centers without embryologists, it will never happen. So we decided to provide training. It was very difficult to find candidates who is willing to train an embryologist, because it's not like there is no also awareness between the healthcare provider. This is a good career, or there is a career for this. So we started this program. And before I address my question to Dr. Kennedy, the president-elect of IFFS, I would like to share with you the video of the first two candidates. When I talk about training, I'm not talking about 1 week and 2 weeks training, because this is not taking anywhere. A lot of you embryologists and understand less than 6 months, or I mean 3 months comprehensive in a very busy IVF practical training, it's the minimum you can accept to develop a good embryologist, which you can train after that and update. And this is what we were looking for. That's why we collaborate. South-South collaboration was very important. We send our embryologists, African embryologists, to Indonesia in a very, very busy training center, and they got 3 months training, and now they are completely standalone, full-fledged embryologists. They can be in Africa. We can send only two at a time. We are hoping with the network today that we have more places can adopt African embryologists for 3 months minimum training, practical and not theory. And the first two candidates was from Uganda and Kenya, and the second will go after 1 week from Nigeria and then from Cote d'Ivoire.
Thank you, Rasha, and it's a great pleasure to be here. And I first of all want to acknowledge Julie Simpson's comments and absolutely endorse those. I believe the IFFS has an important role to support this fantastic initiative, and I think that education is clearly essential, and I think we can support very much the educational and training initiatives which are necessary in countries in Africa to develop the capacity for cost-effective infertility treatment.
Thank you very, very much, Dr. Kennedy.
Thank
you. Really great. And Dr. James, I will address the last question for you, not now, but just keep you tuned, because we will ask Dr. Patrick, the Director of Health Services. From all what you watched today and seen, how do you see Ministry of Health of Kenya can take this forward and make the difference, especially after the ART bill is approved and come out to light?
Thank you, Rasha. And I think the Ministry of Health will have a key role in ensuring that the discussion that Mark started comes to fruition. Once the bill becomes law, then the law has to be implemented as passed by Parliament. And one important role that the Ministry of Health will undertake is to be able to develop policy and guidelines to be able to implement the law. This is in terms of like resource allocation, what resources will be allocated to the ART law that will be formed. What is the scope of the ART? What are we going to offer, especially in public health services? Who gets trained and where do they get trained? Where do we locate the centers of the ART centers? And do we focus on only treatment, or we do a combined approach of treatment and also prevention? Because as said by the previous speakers, infertility in Africa, in sub-Saharan Africa, is significantly contributed to by infections. And therefore, that would be an important role that the Minister of Health will need to undertake. The next role, of course, would be to continue with the advocacy that the champions who are sitting here have been at the forefront, to be able to address the stigma like what Jacqueline went through. That is just but one case of physical violence. But how many more women there in the villages go through both physical and psychological trauma as a result of infertility? We need to be able to pass information that it is not a lost hope, that mothers, infertile couples ought to come to the facilities to seek professional advice so that help could be availed. We need to carry forward the conversation of prevention, especially of sexually transmitted infections, the unsafe abortion agenda, the female genital mutilation, the child marriages, the undernutrition, which all underpin infertility, especially in sub-Saharan African context. I think the other thing that we'll need to focus on is on capacity building, and I thank Mark more than a mother, especially seeing the first two participants come from the sister countries of Kenya and Uganda. It is indeed an honor for Kenya and Uganda to have produced the first. Indeed, for Kenya, that is the first embryologist for a population of more than 42 million. So that tells you that the gap is huge. So a lot will need to be done, and especially when we do demand creation, when couples come for this service, then it is imperative that we have the right human resource who can be able to offer help to the couples who come to seek service. We'll also need to look at the infrastructure environment, both the physical infrastructure, especially for the diagnostics. ART will require a new platform for us to be able to offer treatment to the standards that are required, both for the diagnostic and also for the treatment. And this will come at a cost. And I want to thank my Honorable Member of Parliament, Joyce, for her efforts and encourage her further to work with her colleagues in Parliament to ensure that appropriate budgetary allocation is made when the law is eventually passed to enable us to actualize the law. We have seen in situations where sometimes laws are passed, but concomitantly there's no budgetary allocation and the laws just lie in shelves and our people continue to suffer. This one, for the first time, we expect that when the law is passed, Parliament will also appropriate the necessary budget to ensure that the Ministry of Health can operationalize the law. Finally, the Ministry of Health will play a crucial role in ensuring standards and regulations are maintained. Couples who suffer from infertility will go to an extent to be able to have a baby, and they are sometimes exploited by quacks masquerading as specialists, and therefore the Ministry of Health will have to provide oversight in ensuring that standards and regulatory framework is in place to ensure that those centers which are carrying out ART then maintain specific standards. And finally, I want to thank Mark for allowing the Minister of Health Kenya to be part of this discussion, and we look forward to working with you in driving this agenda forward. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Patrick. Before we have the last question for Dr. James, I would like to open the floor for questions. Any questions for our ministers and parliaments? And
what do the ministers, where do they see all of this going, where we have increasing infertility rates on one hand and increasing human life loss in terms of abortion rates? Where do we see this going?
Okay. What we all want is for everybody to do what is best for him or her. Every mother or every man, every woman on earth wants to have a child the moment you get married. However, when you hear about an abortion, then you know that that is an unwanted pregnancy. And these unwanted pregnancies arise sometimes as a result of rape, as a result of defilement, but also as a result of lack of contraceptives. You know, the unmet need for contraceptives is also high, and especially in most developing countries. So abortions are done by those who do not want pregnancies. But we also have so many couples out there that actually want to have a baby, but they unfortunately cannot have the baby. So we are talking about infertility, and of course, trying to help the many people out there. For example, as I said, in my country, in Uganda, between 15 to 20% of couples that try or want to have a baby cannot have the baby. So we are saying that this is a human rights issue. Those who want to have babies should be allowed to have babies, should be assisted to have babies, and of course should have information as to where they can be able to receive the healthcare services so that they can have children. So abortions are there, and we may not be able to stop them, but as I said, those are unwanted pregnancies. It should be children by choice, not children, by force or other means.
There were a couple of comments made that when you talked with policymakers that there was a lot of support for this initiative. Many of us in the medical field have struggled for a long time to try to get the public and policymakers and payers to pay any attention to those with infertility. Could someone comment on what do you think has been the single message that's resonated the most with policymakers or the public that has caused them to become supporters of this initiative as opposed to ignoring it, which has been a chronic condition for the past few decades? Are there one or two messages that actually have resonated and caused people to say, yes, I want to help?
Infertility has led to several suicide attempts and several psychological disturbances leading to psychiatric admission. So infertility has led to a lot of violent abuses on women. So when you list all those, then it becomes a concern for the world over to take this issue for those who do not have it, who do not have access. Because as WHO recognized, infertility, having babies is a human right issue. Hence, help must be given to those who want to have it, just as help is being given to those who want to control it.
Thank you.
Can I maybe supplement to what he has said? I am the Minister of State for Health from Uganda. And we are seeing a number of political leaders now coming up to support this initiative by Merck. I want to really commend Merck for this initiative. Because as you heard, infertility has been there. Infertility has existed. And as I said, since man was created. For those who are Christians, the story of Abraham and Sarah is not new to all of you. But the issue here is that nobody has actually come up to speak about this challenge. And Merck has picked on this niche. When they came to Uganda, I must really tell you that when Russia approached me, it took me time to really understand why we should be into this. But later, as we continued with the conversation, I then said this is something that we must actually get involved in as policymakers. And as you all know, this is the 22nd Congress. You have been meeting as fertility societies across the world, but the political leaders have not been involved. And therefore, the IVF services have been increasing. ART is increasing in various countries, but there is no regulation. There is no law. In my own country, as I said, there are 5 clinics operating, providing these services, and they're all private, but there is no regulation. But I'm happy to state that the Ministry of Health, working with the Uganda Medical and Dental Practitioners Council, has now a draft regulation. We are waiting for the Solicitor General, the legal arm of government, to input into it and have a law to regulate these services in the country. Thank you.
And also to add on the same, we've gotten there because we also have politicians who have gone through the same experience. And having that platform where you're able to reach out to people, you're able to send your message down for them to know even whatever it is that they're going through. You as a member of parliament has also gone through the same. It's only that we didn't have time. We could have shown my video because I've gone through the same experience and I had my child through a surrogate mother. And so when I got elected, I had this platform. And I said, I cannot keep quiet. I have to change the law. Because after I had my son, I had to adopt my son. Because there was no law in Kenya that would allow for surrogacy, that would allow me to have that child as my own baby. So it took me 4 years to adopt my own child. And because I had that platform as a policymaker, I had to take that opportunity to make sure that we change the law so that other couple and women behind me could not suffer the same problem. Thank you.
Thank you. I think one powerful message that has rallied parliamentarians and policymakers is the fact that the message is infertility. Over 60% of the cause are treatable, caused by infection, and it can be prevented. The preventability and how it can be prevented has made many parliamentarians to go out to let the people understand that when you prevent infection, then you can avoid infertility. That is one powerful message that has rallied. Thank you.
An infertile woman is rejected from all its human rights. So what Merck is going to do in Asian countries, especially in our country, Afghanistan, where there is only one IVF center. So, I mean, Pakistan, India, Bangladesh, also they are suffering the same.
I would like, thank you. Yes, we are actually talking about launching.
being an organizer and we are crossing the time, I will make very short that when I bid for this conference, my object or my dream was to set up an institute in India, because India is not underdeveloped country, it is developing country, it is going ahead. We have got infrastructure, we have got excellent talents, and we have got devoted people to work with us. With IFFS, with the Merck, and with Indian Society of Indian Society for Assisted Reproduction and Indian Fertility Society, we are prepared to set up an embryology training institute in India if all of you are ready to support us. We are there to work for you. And already Indian Fertility Society is running embryology training program along with the European Society of Reproductive Medicine. So if Merck joins with the Indian Fertility Society, we can take up the training program for embryologists. Thank you very
Thank
much.
Thank you very, very much. Thank
and may I also endorse and support what my fellow panelists have said before. And I would also like to thank the outgoing president of IFFS, Professor Joe Simpson, and the incoming president for supporting this initiative. Critically, I would now address the issue about training and escalating the More Than a Mother program and cascading it down to the frontline service. I want to address it in two particular areas. One is that of bringing up competence in a key area of service delivery. That is what Merck and us, the African Fertility Society, have identified that a critical bottleneck is in the embryology competence. We also recognize that in the high end of treatment, you often stimulate the base, because the base, which has been resigned to a hopeless situation, now becomes energized that there is now hope. So the message of preventive care becomes more acceptable and more easy to deliver. I want to address the second issue, that's the issue of what happens to the doctors and the healthcare providers themselves in the context of the More Than a Mother campaign. And I want to say two things particularly. One is how to approach fertility care as an holistic program, to have a dual diagnosis, the medical diagnosis as well as the psychosocial disorder. The second thing is to incorporate within the monitoring system, within the new registry, incorporate infertility and social stigma issue as one of the components to be monitored and reported on annually. Thank you very much.
Thank you very, very much. We now at the end of our campaign. I'd like to thank all my guests. I'd like to thank you for your patience and listening to us. Of course, all the videos and the stories of women which we did not show today, there is hundreds of them in our YouTube, Merck More Than a Mother. But I suggest to watch one video per day because they are a little bit sad. And now, regarding Asia expansion of Merck More Than a Mother, I would like to discuss that offline. Thank you very much for all support, and we will meet you at the coffee break. Thank you.